is that when you want to study interaction of these particles, it becomes very, very easy and useful to use the concept of the field. Okay? So this I had advertised long back. And at the level of classical field theory, we also studied quite a few examples where the fields are interacting. So I wanted to first orient you for that, and then we will go further. So if you think in terms of a relativistic particle, you have a particle which is free and which satisfies a particular equation, which is fairly trivial. Now you can think of a charged particle and then put this charged particle in an electromagnet. The moment you do that, the charged particle is going to feel the force from the electromagnetic field, the standard Lorentz force. And the field which is moving is also going to produce electromagnetic field. So this is what you mean by interaction. Now, as long as you think in terms of particle trajectories and you are doing classical particle mechanics, there is a way of doing this. But the moment you think of these particles as excitation of the field, which is what we have been doing, and give field certain level of reality, you now have to study how the excitation of an underlying field interacts with other excitations. So for example, there are photons which are excitations of the electromagnetic field. And there is this color mesons, so to speak, charged mesons. I mean, for the lack of better name, charged color particle. Take a complex color field, which is going to be, these particles are going to be excitations of a complex color field. And we want to couple these charged particles to the electromagnetic. Now at the classical level, we have already done that. So we wrote down at some stage an action like this, or rather the Lagrangian like this, if you remember. The L was something like dA phi. Classically it was star, quantum mechanically it will become diagonal. Then dA phi minus m square phi square. Minus 1/4 FAB, which I will just write as F square. So let us look at the structure of this. This dA here stands for the standard covariant derivative, Gaussian invariant derivative, which is dA minus I AA, pardon, minus I cube AA, where AA is the vector potential. And this F contains purely this vector potential. Now if you expand it out, you are going to get terms in this which are just going to be dA phi star, dA phi star. Then there is going to be an m square phi square. That much is the free field. Then there is going to be this F square term, which is also a free field. But there is going to be a coupling between this A and the derivatives of it. So you are going to pick up a times J, where J is a current, that kind of a coupling. And in this particular case, I also told you that the current is going to have a term which is proportional to mod phi square, which comes from this, times A. Okay, so there is also a self-coupling which is involved. So the general structure of such a theory can be described by saying that the Lagrangian has three terms. So there is an L1, which depends on just this field phi and phi star. Then there is an L2, which depends on just capital A. Then there is an L3, which couples these two, which depends on both phi and phi. Now, what do I mean by an interacting field versus free field? The statement is very trivial. If the field equations are linear in the field, then you call it a free field. For example, if I had dA phi, dA phi, and then m square phi square, if it is up to quadratic, when I write down from the field equation from the Lagrangian, you are going to take a derivative with respect to phi, you will end up getting box by, plus m square phi is equal to 0. Okay? So if phi 1 is a solution and phi 2 is a solution, phi 1 plus phi 2 is also a solution. So if the field equations are linear, you call it a free field, in the sense that every mode of that field is going to propagate freely. If the field equations are non-linear, you call it an interacting. This is the basic definition. So if you look at this, obviously this is an interacting field. This term is a free field, this term is a free field. Well, the moment you switch this on, there is going to be an interaction. And this switching will be proportional to Q. That is obvious, because when Q goes to 0, this capital dA becomes small dA. So this is the just your L1, this is just L2. So Q is the coupling constant which couples both of these. Now our aim is to study this. Now even classically, it's a non-trivial problem. If you write down the differential equations which come from this, you will have a set of coupled differential equations, one for phi and one for E, and you want to find solutions to this. Exact solutions to such configurations are, there are a few, but not many. Okay, it is not an easy problem to solve. Which tells you that quantum mechanically the problem is almost hopeless if you are looking for exact solution, except in some very special cases like 1 plus 1 dimension, etc. So in general, these partial differential equations cannot be solved. So if I write down the operator equations arising from this Lagrangian, broadly speaking, I will have structures like some box phi is equal to something which I will call f of phi and a. And I will have another equation which can be in the Lorentz gauge, can be written as box a is equal to some other quantity, I'll call it kj, which will depend on phi and a. If q was 0, the f and kj will vanish, and you will decouple these things, box a and box phi is equal to 0, these are the free. Now we are interested in the situation where these things are there, and they are proportional to this coupling constant q. So I'm attached to q. This is one kind of interaction which we come up with. There is also another kind of interaction which we have studied. What we have done is that we have looked at models for scalar field itself with Lagrangian, L is equal to, let us say, half real field, dA phi, dA phi, minus V of phi. For example, let me just keep minus V. If this V was quadratic in phi, like m square phi square, then the field equations will again be linear. So then it is a free field. But if V is more than quadratic, like lambda phi 4 which we studied, then again this is going to be an interacting case. Now it is not two separate fields which are interacting, it is just that the single field itself has a coupling to itself. The field equation now will become, this will lead to a field equation which is of the form box phi is equal to minus V prime of phi. For any V which is more than quadratic, V prime of phi will be more than linear. It will be, you know, quadratic, cubic, etc. If it is lambda phi 4, it will be cubic. Therefore, this particular differential equation also is very difficult to solve it exactly. And we want to study what is happening. If it is a lambda phi 4 theory, again there will be a coupling constant lambda which is sitting here, just like this coupling constant Q. When you switch it off, it is going to become a free field theory. When you switch it on, it is going to give you an interacting. Okay? So the interaction can be between two different fields, or it could be a self-coupling of the same field. Both the types create the same kind of headaches for us. Now the question is, how do we tackle this? How do we do this in quantum? Now I want to give you a broad introduction to this picture, because we don't have sufficient time to do interacting field theories in great detail. So I'm going to have two more lectures this week and another three lectures next week. So I'll try to cover as much as possible, but fortunately some of the aspects which I'm not going to cover are very well discussed in textbooks. So those of you who are interested can pursue it on your own, but I will give you an orientation for it. And I will do things which are usually not covered in textbooks. The two main approaches to attack this problem is called perturbative and non-perturbative. Now the perturbative method is what is usually discussed in most of the textbooks, and as a result of which I am going to do non-perturbative first. Okay, because that is what I want to cover. So the perturbative approach, let me finish off that, is fairly simple. When you study any of these systems, ultimately you are interested in evaluating a path in it. That is another way of stating the same problem. Because if you know the classical action and you can compute the quantity,
which is integral over, let us look at the scalar field first, integral over d phi of this exponential I integral of whatever Lagrangian I have been writing there down times d 4 x. If I can compute this, usually with a j phi also added to the Lagrangian, then I know the system complete. Because the moment I have added a j phi and I compute this as a functional of that j, we did this long back for the scalar field, for a free scalar field, then by differentiating with respect to j, you can construct a whole lot of objects like phi at x, phi at y, where this bracket either means you take a time ordering of this and then take a vacuum expectation value, or you do the same path integral with a phi at x and phi at y inside. So it's like an average, the either a path integral average or a vacuum expectation value average of quantities like this. In an interacting field theory, you may also want to study more general structures like phi at x1, phi at x2, all the way up to, let us say, phi at xn. These objects are called n-point functions, and the simplest is the two-point function, which is what we have called propagator for a particle. Okay? Now, this we will do in the next week. Essentially, you know that these are like averages with an exponential here. Suppose this exponential was quadratic in phi. So suppose it is phi d phi. It is like averaging a set of Gaussian variables, right? Because the probability distribution is Gaussian. So you are talking about a set of Gaussian variables qi, q1, q2, q3, qn. And you are calculating things like qi, qj average, qi, qj, qk, ql, etc. average, etc. For Gaussian, you know that if I know qi, qj average, the two-point function, I mean, we are talking about Gaussians with zero mean. So all odd moments vanish. In the even moments, if I know qi, qj average, then I can compute everything, right? So if I have four of them, then it is just pairwise average multiplied together. There are only a two-point correlation function, which is non-trivial for a Gaussian. So the trick in perturbative field theory is to write this down, and in the Lagrangian you retain just the quadratic term, take all other terms and do a Taylor series expansion in the coupling constant. So you are going to get a whole lot of products of phi sitting there, and once you have got that, any n-point function will be a product of a whole bunch of phi with a Gaussian average, which can be computed. Okay. So perturbatively, you can calculate these quantities to arbitrary order of accuracy. So in principle, if you have given a theory like this and you have non-quadratic terms in that, you already know the procedure. Then why is it that people who do quantum electrodynamics get Nobel Prizes? The reason is when you compute this, you find that the expressions are divergent. Okay. So you calculate any of these Green's functions and you find that when you work it out, these expressions are divergent. So this was a major problem, one of the problems, and people needed to know how to handle this. The way traditional textbooks teach quantum field theory is to introduce up to interacting fields, then they may do path integrals or they may do some Heisenberg evolution in interaction picture or whatever, and they will reduce to this perturbation theory. And this perturbation theory can be written down very nicely in terms of a set of diagrams called Feynman diagram, which essentially is a one-to-one mapping between these algebraic expressions. So these Feynman diagrams, when you compute, they will show that things are divergent. And at this stage, they will introduce a procedure called renormalization, which allows you to remove these divergences, that is, reinterpret the theory handling these divergences. Now this sometimes, and in fact, in the conventional way of doing things, even historically people thought about field theory like this. So they thought of field theories as those which are perturbatively renormalizable and perturbatively non-renormalizable. I will describe to you in a minute what that means. I mean, essentially, assume that there are infinities and there is a class of theories, let's call it class A, in which these infinities can be handled in some way. Okay? and so as to get finite answer. The class B are the theories in which it cannot be handled. So the class A theories were called perturbatively renormalizable, or just renormalizable for short, which is a bad name. Or the class B theories were called perturbatively non-renormalizable. Now the basic philosophy in the early days was that these non-perturbative theories are bad theories and perturbative theories are good theory, and the whole quest in physics was to look for a way of doing describing all interaction using these perturbative models. Okay, and it has been great success, and that is why that idea just percolated. Like quantum mechanical dynamics was a classic example of a perturbatively renormalizable theory. After that, when strong and weak interactions were being studied, originally weak interactions were described by something called a four point Fermi interaction, and that one was not perturbatively renormalizable. Later on, it was in electromagnetic and weak interactions were unified into a perturbatively renormalizable theory, which is called the Salam-Lindbergh theory. Similarly, there is a theory for strong interactions called QCD, which also has these features. So there is a whole lot of theories which are perturbatively renormalizable, and the classic exception is gravity, and that is why most of the conventional methods fail in gravity. However, over a period of time, people have realized that this philosophy is somewhat limited. Okay? So I'm going to advocate an alternate philosophy, which is probably the more modern view of it. The idea here is that renormalization, okay, so let us take a closer look at what I mean by renormalization and what I mean by this class A theories in which the divergences can be handled. What essentially happens is the following. Let us say that you start with a Lagrangian, which has certain coupling constants or certain constants. Okay? In principle, there will be a constant in front of this, even though we have put it as half, and which is relevant, it's called wave function, renormalization constant, etc. But let us ignore that for a thing. So let us consider constants which come in VFI. VFI in the simplest kind of theory, like a lambda phi 4 theory, has a m square and a lambda. So there's a mass term and a coupling constant, right? So if you want to study this perturbativity, you retain the mass term and then you do a perturbation theory in lambda. Now when you do this, you end up getting infinitely terms which are divergent or which are infinite. Now let us assume for a minute that you can handle these infinities by changing the form of the coupling constant and that is these divergent terms can be reabsorbed into by redefining the two parameters m and lambda. I will show you in a minute how it comes about. It's actually simpler than what I have been describing in plain English. So suppose it can be done. Then you say that, look, I can start a theory with these renormalized coupling constants and the mass, and if everything is finite in that, these are the things which I will be observing. Now this is a priori nothing to do with divergence. So the idea is the following. Suppose you study electron in a crystal lattice, and you think of the force applied to the electron by some mean, and you calculate what is the mass, the effective mass or the inertia the electron has. The electron is strongly coupled to things in the crystal lattice. As a result of which, when you compute it, you will find that it has an effective mass which is different from the mass of the electron outside of the crystal lattice. Now this is, and both the masses are finite, it can be computed, and this is something which condensed matter physicists know quite a lot. So the mass gets renormalized in the presence of the lattice because of the interaction. The main difference between that and field theory is that in the case of a lattice, you do have the concept of a solid with an electron in it, and you can take that electron out of the solid and keep it outside. So you can experimentally observe both the masses, the mass when this interactions with the lattice is switched off, so to speak, the free electron, and the mass when the electron is interacting with the lattice. As a result of it, it is meaningful to think in terms of a bare mass and an effective mass, because both are experimentally observable. However, in the case of a field theory, that is not the case. You cannot take an electron and switch off its electromagnetic interactions and ask what is its mass. So there is only one mass, And the electron, you may want to divide the Lagrangian into all kinds of pieces, but that is your human fallibility. Nature doesn't do that. Nature looks at the whole picture. So the nature always have an electron with its electromagnetic field around it. So the electron is always interacting with the electromagnetic field. So there is no such thing as a bare electron in the absence of Q. This is the main problem, so to speak, the philosophical problem with perturbative field theories. The perturbative field theory start by assuming that you let us start with a situation where Q is equal to 0.
Sir, can this also tell us more about how the electron's mass comes from the
from the interaction itself? Well, people have tried that. People have tried to attribute all the mass of the electron because of its interaction with something, etc. None of those models have succeeded. So as far as charge and mass are concerned, so far we do not understand where it comes from. We don't know where masses of any of the elementary particles come from. You know how to put it in, but then somebody has to tell you what its numerical value is. We don't know any fundamental way of computing it or relating it to something more deep. Okay, so that's a completely unsolved problem.
With respect to renormalization, is it related to the high frequency cutoff?
Yeah, that we are going to come to. I'm still at an introductory stage. Then when we do the maths properly, it will come. Okay, so right now, the perturbative field theory starts by assuming there is something called free fields, where the interaction is switched off. And then you switch on the interaction. Now this is philosophically not a very happy situation, because even if you think in terms of, for example, the scattering of two electrons, experimentally of course you can keep two charged particles far away so that they are not really seeing each other. Then scatter it off and then it again goes to far away distances and you can calculate scattering cross-section and things like that, and whatever you do agrees very well with the experiment. But you can never really think of the Q of the electron or Q of the scattering particles in electromagnetism being switched off, because it is always there and you cannot do that. So in some sense you have to do this in a mathematically in a very, very, what I would say is a very delicate manner in order to give meaning to this perturbative. This has been done, but there is an issue here. On the other hand, if you accept the fact that there is always omnipresent coupling constants in there, then there is a much nicer and unified picture which emerges. What you do is the following. You say that, look, what is a coupling constant? Let us concentrate on the coupling constant, lambda. If I want to understand what is the coupling constant which is here, I have to take these pi mesons or whatever particle this field describes and scatter it off each other. So once I had done that scattering experiment, and if I know the scattering cross-section, using the theoretical prediction and the observed result, I can calculate what lambda is. When you look at it this way, it makes sense that the result is going to depend on the energy scale at which you are going to observe. So you have a particular energy scale in which you determine the coupling constant. Now you can ask, if I am studying the whole thing at a much higher energy scale or lower energy scale, how do I describe the interaction? It turns out that in a very manner of speaking, you use a coupling constant which changes with energy. This is called a running coupling constant. That is, the interactions between these different field modes tells you that the coupling constant which you are thinking about. Normally you think of coupling constant at very low energies. As you go to higher and higher energies, the coupling constant need not remain the same thing, but it will run with it. And this is the philosophy behind what is known as renormalization rule. And this is the philosophy which I'm going to advocate and describe to you. Now first let us ask, what does it mean to say that a coupling constant is actually running? This is closely related to another issue. Suppose you are looking at any nonlinear field theory. Let us take this field theory. Let us assume that there is a phi cube term here. That is, I have a lambda phi 4, so this is going to have a lambda phi cube. Now, what does lambda phi cube mean in contrast to just a phi? This difference is very striking if you look at it in Fourier space. Suppose I Fourier transform phi on all x, y, z and t, then I have the momentum space modes, phi fp. Now, the momenta each moment I characterize as a phi fp. So instead of thinking of the degrees of freedom as phi fx, I could have equally well thought of the momentum as the variable and say that the degrees of freedom are phi fp. For every momentum scale, I have the field degrees of freedom. In a linear field theory, these degrees of freedom are decoupled. That is, if I think of the momentum translate into some energy. If I think of energy or wavelength or frequency or any one of these equivalent descriptions, the modes with a particular energy do not talk to modes with a different energy. Modes at every different energy evolves independently. This is just to say it is a linear thing. Okay, because I can linearly superpose all phi p's and get the field. But if you are talking about a theory which has a lambda phi cube, it tells you that the mode with a momentum p talks to modes with momentum p prime for all values of p. Okay. Now this is already bringing in a little bit of another philosophical issue. So if the field is coupled to, suppose you are looking at the phenomena at some energy scale, but because of this couples that energy scale to all the higher energy scale, you have a theory in which the energy scale E is coupled to all the higher energy scale, all the way to infinity. But this is a bit funny because nobody in the real, you know, with some level of sanity will assume that we understand physics to arbitrarily high energies. Experimentally, if you look at it, we know probably physics up to few DeVs, okay, or hundreds of DeVs. So at those scales, we have experimental data. But if I'm going all the way up to infinity, infinity is a long way from there. So if you want to couple to all of them, you don't even know whether the original Lagrangian which you wrote down is meaningful. You don't even know whether at when you approach Planck scale, the entire space-time description is meaningful. So if the behavior of a field at an energy scale, say 1 GeV, is going to depend on how the field is behaving at 10 to the 19 GeV, then you are sunk. You cannot do field theory at all. Okay? Now this is an interesting point. Suppose you take fluid. Normal fluid in which you write down the equations of motion for the fluid variables. Now fluid we know is ultimately built out of particles, molecules, which are interacting by molecular interaction forces. The idea of a fluid with a density, velocity, etc. is an approximation. It's an approximation of the condition. Now if you write down the fluid equation, you will find that the modes of the fluid again couple to each other. Okay, that is the, if you take a particular wavelength or a frequency of the fluid, take wavelength, if you think of a perturbation or a wave in the fluid at a given wavelength, it is coupled to waves at much smaller wavelengths, all the way to infinity. Now when you go in the wavelength space to smaller and smaller scales, you are probing the fluid at smaller and smaller length scale. And we know that if you go up to a length scale like 10 to the minus 7 or 10 to the minus 8 centimeter, you are actually breaking down the fluid approximation and you are looking at something like an atomic and molecular structure of the matter. Now how is it that none of the complications at the atomic scale ever affect you when you are writing down the Navier-Stokes equation for a fluid? The reason is that all these complications can be associated with some coupling constants like the viscosity coefficient. So the coefficients of viscosity and even things like thermal conductivity, etc., these coefficients which you write down for a fluid is essentially a description, an effective description of very high energy or low wavelength, small wavelength modes of it. Okay. So the discrete nature of the field can be sort of approximated in terms of some well-chosen coefficients. If you take another example, which is like a spin system in a lattice. Suppose you take a cubic lattice and at every lattice point you put a spin and you put a coupling between the spins. This is the classic Ising model if you have a particular kind of coupling. Now if you want to describe this, it is entirely possible that instead of looking at every lattice, which is the ultimate primordial description, you take a coarse-grained view, that is you take a block of the solid containing let us say 10 by 10 by 10 lattice size. Or 100 by 100 by 100 lattice height, or in general n by n by n lattice height. Now you call it a block and you average all the spins inside it, you add them all up vectorially. Then you get an effective spin and put it at the center of that object. Now you can think of the coupling between this block and the next adjacent block.
So you have sort of washed out all the details inside, and you are going to talk about the interaction between these two. Now, if you know the original interaction, then you can actually compute this average and calculate what is this average interaction. So what you are doing is that you are averaging the original description over a length scale L, and you are writing down an effective description which is valid at that length scale, that is above that length scale or below a particular energy level. So you average, in context of field theory, you average very high energy modes, and you can write down a field theory, an effective field theory at lower energies. Now suppose you do this, such a theory is called an effective field theory. When you average out this high energy modes, suppose you take a scale capital M, and you say that you are going to integrate out all the modes above that capital. In principle, you can go from M to infinity, but you could have taken, no condensed matter physicist would do that, because no condensed matter physicist believes that his description of some kind of an average density and velocities or continuum variables is valid at a lattice spacing. He knows that there is a lattice. So as a result of which, he will have a cutoff, which is essentially at a lattice spacing. Now we do not know whether the space-time has some cutoff or not, or whether it's a continuum all the way. But there is nothing wrong in assuming that there is some cutoff. And then you have a scale M. From M to some upper cutoff lambda, you integrate everything out. This upper cutoff lambda is sort of God given. In principle, once you have done that, all your effective description at scales below this M will depend on these two parameters M and lambda. So for example, the coupling constant which you compute after averaging out is high energy degrees of freedom will depend on this M and lambda. This is why coupling constants run with this scale. So this M is an energy scale above which you have integrated out the modes, and you are looking at an effective description below that, and that description will depend on it. Of course, it will also depend on lambda. Now you can ask what happens when lambda goes to infinity. In the kind of theories which we will be studying, when you send lambda to infinity, in a class of theory, the class A theories, it will diverge. Okay? When it diverges, in principle, you may think that there is a problem. But there is a set of theories in which you can sort of reabsorb them into the coupling constant. But there are other class of theories in which you cannot reabsorb. How do you describe the second class of theories? The old point of view is that these theories are sick theories and there is no hope for them and we should not outquit it. But a more rational point of view would be to say that these are effective field theories. These are field theories which are valid below an energy scale E, and there is a cutoff in that theory, and that cutoff is specified by some physical phenomena above which you cannot talk about this effective field theory. Okay? So the point of view which one would take here is that the theory, the interacting field theories involve different energy scales coupled to each other. In order to talk meaningfully about the theory, you can integrate out the modes between an energy band E and some lambda, where lambda is an ultimate coupling scale. And that will tell you how to describe theories at energy scales much below E. Once you have done that, this is going to depend on the lower cutoff which I have chosen and on the upper cutoff lambda. This will change all the coupling constants, etc. In principle, you can then send this upper cutoff lambda to infinity, and if they are divergent, so be it. And from this point of view, the coupling constant changing with scale is independent of whether it's the original coupling constant you started with is is a finite value or an infinite value. Okay, so you just think in terms of this effective coupling constant. Okay, so this is what I want to describe. And now I want to describe this with some amount of mathematics problem. So in order to do that, we will go back to a concept which we introduced long back, which is the concept of effective action. So let me just reiterate that. It is much easier to understand in terms of two fields or 2 degrees of freedom. This is going to be very formal, so it doesn't really matter what they are. So let us say that you have a theory involving two fields, which I will just call capital Q and small q. Okay? It's purely generic. And then there is an action, e to the I, action which depends on capital Q and
small. It doesn't even matter whether this two are like quantum mechanical degrees of freedom or a field theoretic degree of freedom, etc. As I said, it's a very formal kind of a description. Now, in principle, if I can do this path integral, then everything is fine. And the path integral can only be done for those theories where the theory is linear, which is the same as saying the path integral has to be quadratic, the gradient should be quadratic. However, let us assume for a minute that I can do one of the path integrals. Okay? That is, you assume capital Q to have some particular value, either a field configuration or some such thing. And I do this second path integral. If I have integrated out this Q, what will remain here is something which depends on capital Q. So I will write this purely formally as e to the I some, okay, let me be a little bit more precise. This A of Q, I will write in the following form. A naught of Q, just as this Lagrangian was written, that makes life a little easier. Then A1 of small q, and let us say A2 of which depends on both q and q. If this was not there, this is two independent theories, and we can even assume that they are free theories. It is this which is the coupling q to capital Q to small q, and which is introducing the interaction. So when I do the dq interaction, this term doesn't contribute. So I do the integral over both of these, and I end up getting, this remains as it is, and I will end up getting e to the I, there is a a naught of q, then there will be some function of capital Q. It is good to write that function as some a effective of capital. Okay? So e to the I a effective of capital Q is the new function. Nobody told you that it is a pure phase, which means that the a effective need not be real. It can, so any function can be written as e to the I times another function. But if it is, if it doesn't have modulus unity, then this will pick up an imaginary. But that is fine. We will come back to that. So you have something like this. Now this is something just to connect with what we have done before. If you recall, we did a JFX, ΦFX coupling when we first did quantum field theory. So think of this capital Q as phi, think of this this small q as j, and think of this as a linear coupling between phi and j. Then we did do an integration over phi and obtained something which was e to the minus half integral dx1, dx2, j at x1, j at x2, and a propagator x1, x2, right? That is just the effective action for the j degree of freedom. At that time, we never wrote down an action for the j degree of freedom, but we could have. So we had already done one elementary example of a field theory, but that field theory is so trivial in the sense that that coupling is linear. So there is a way of diagonalizing it and making it into a free field theory. But in principle, we have done that effective action. That is important because at that time we found that that effective action has a real and imaginary parts, right? And the real part of the effective action essentially gave you the energy of the self-interaction energy of the scalar field. We found a Yukawa potential self-interacting energy. The imaginary part of the effective action gave you the rate of creation of the phi particle by the external source J. Okay? The vacuum to vacuum amplitude was written down by that. So this e to the I A effective is nothing but the term. So that is e to the I A effective, which I am introducing now, is nothing but what we have been calling the plus vacuum and the minus vacuum in the presence of an external source J. Here it is called Q. Okay, and the mode square of that gave you the probability for creation of the particles from the imaginary part of the effective action. So all these we have done before, at least in one example. So we are just generalizing. Now there are some very interesting things which you can study here, even without doing anything further. Suppose your A naught of phi was something like this theory, without a lambda phi photon. Think of that lambda phi 4 as this. Or let us take electromagnetism, that is easier. Think of this A naught of this particular term as the L2 of A. That is, think of this as an electromagnetic field. And think of this Q as a scalar field. So there is an electromagnetic field sitting here. And this Q is a scalar field phi. And this is the interaction between them. Okay, this is the action which I started with. Now suppose I integrate out the scalar field. Then I end up getting a term where this A naught of Aj is just 1 quarter F square. It is just this term. Okay? So there was the standard electromagnetic action, E square minus B square. That is what is sitting here. Then after you integrate out, you are going to get an effective action, which is going to depend on electric and magnetic. Alright? Now you ask the question, suppose I do this, what kind of terms am I going to generate? More generally, suppose I start with some generic action function, which has a Q degree of freedom, and it has a set of coupling constants. Then I introduce an interaction, and then I generate an effective action. Suppose this effective action produces terms which has exactly the same structure as in A naught. This is a very crucial point. Suppose this A naught originally had a term like M square phi square. After you do the integral and all that, suppose this A effective also had a term which is a mu square phi square. Okay, so this theory will have m square plus mu square times phi square. Now the question is, what is the mass of the physical mass of the particle? Now if you want to look at the physical mass of the particle, you want to understand, I mean there will be some experiment which is going to measure it. But any such experiment will couple that field to the rest of the world. You cannot switch off these interactions. So you think of the mass term as the term which is the coefficient of phi square in the action. But the coefficient of phi square in the action is not the coefficient which you put in. You put an m square phi square, then you said that there is an interaction. Now if I integrate out that interaction, then the effective action produces a mu square phi square. So it is m square plus mu square which is the physical mass. This is exactly the same argument about an effective mass of the electron. You have an electron, you put it in a lattice and you then work out its dynamics. You don't do it with path integrals or whatever, but you can. When you work out the dynamics, you find that the acceleration and the force are related by a thing F by A is equal to some effective value. And here the coefficient of the phi square term or Q square term identifies that effective value. And that term is going to be different from the bare M square which you are throwing. So it tells you that once you integrate out another degree of freedom, you may generate a term here. Now suppose originally this had a set of coupling constants, C1, C2, C3, some C10. You integrate it out and each of these terms are coming with particular kind of coefficient. One might have a phi square, something else might have a phi cube, something else might have a phi log phi, whatever. When you do this interaction and integrate it out, suppose you generate only the same kind of terms. Okay? Then you are in luck. You can absorb all of them into this and the interaction merely redefines the coupling constants. Okay. Now suppose for a minute when you do this, you end up getting terms, coefficients of this, which are divergent. But if the coefficients, suppose there is a m square phi square term originally, when you do this integral, you end up getting a mu square phi square term, where the mu depends on a high energy cutoff. And when the cutoff goes to infinity, mu diverges. It doesn't matter. Because mu square plus m square is what you are going to observe. You arrange things in such a way that mu square by m square is equal to the observed mass of the particle. Therefore, you have eliminated the divergence. So the philosophy is that when you integrate out the interaction, if it generates terms which are already present in the original Lagrangian, all those kinds of divergences are immaterial. Okay? Now it will also generate finite terms. I mean, after all, we want some non-trivial theory. So the effect of the interaction will be to produce a bunch of divergent terms
which you reabsorb with the coupling constant, then there will be some finite term, which is okay. Now suppose it generates a new term with a coefficient which is divergent, which is not originally present in it. Okay? So suppose you started with a lambda 5-4 theory, and when you did an interaction and you integrated out some mode, it produced a 5 to the power 6 term. Okay. Now, normally this is a problem. What you can try to do is to change your original lambda 5-4 theory to a lambda 1-5-4 plus lambda 2-5-6 and then redo the computation. If it still only generates up to 5-6, well and good, because you could have reabsorbed that lambda 2-5-6 by this. But suppose when you throw in this 5-6, it now produces a 5 to the power 19 term. Now, in general, if this keeps going on, you are in trouble. The usual concept of a non-renormalizable theory is a theory, when you do this kind of a computation, you end up generating terms which are divergent and which cannot be reabsorbed by redefining the coupling constants. Okay? What is more, if you try to introduce those terms, it will generate still more different terms, and this process never ends. So again, the old-fashioned point of view about such theories is that they are bad theories because you cannot make sense out of them. A slightly better point of view about that theories is that these theories generate new terms. These new terms should be thought of as describing interactions below a particular threshold. And you should not use this theory at high enough threshold. And all these extra terms should be defined with a cutoff, and the physical value of that cutoff has to come from the experiment again, or from some theoretical consideration. So at energy scales much below that cutoff, these new terms which has been generated will have an effect, and that is why it is called an effect. Okay? So this is the philosophy which I am going to adopt. Now let me, so once after we have caught up to this, we are going to do both electromagnetism and lambda 5-4, and electromagnetism gives you some very beautiful results. Lambda 5-4 is good because it is more elementary, and we will first start with the lambda 5-4. Now here I took 2 degrees of freedom and I integrated them out. And I took this A effective, and let me just finish off a few elementary things here. First of all, this A effective, as I said, can have a real part and an imaginary. The conventional way of thinking about this effective action is that you take this A0 and add to it the real part of it, and you think of this as an effective action. The imaginary part is there, and that is supposed to describe this particle production by this external field. Okay? How to take that into account dynamics is a kind of a non-trivial problem which is not completely resolved, and you have to do it in a case-by-case basis. The other issue which we want to study here is that this capital Q and small q need not actually be two different things. So let me, and that is closer to the philosophy which I have been advocating. Let us say that you take this field phi and you write it as, take this field phi and write it as phi slow plus phi fast. Just a terminology. Slow means it is varying slowly with space and time. Fast means it is varying very rapidly with space and time. Okay? So this phi fast probes very small length scales and corresponds to very high frequencies. And slow is some kind of a background. So you think of it as a wave with on top of it there are ripples. What we would like to have is a description of the slow modes after integrating out the fast modes. So the idea is again the same. You go and substitute this into the Lagrangian. Okay, so you take this, you now define you as z. In principle, this is an integral over all phi, which means it is an integral over phi s and phi cos of e to the I action, which can be thought of as of phi s plus phi cos. Okay, if it is not quadratic, this is going to couple fast and slow modes in a very non-trivial way, and I can again integrate out this fast modes and end up getting integral d phi slow e to the I, an effective action,
for this domain. So you can think of this as divided into frequency space between energy scales. So suppose you take 5 fast as everything above a cutoff scale capital M, and 5 slow as everything at a cutoff scale less than capital M. So this corresponds to scales greater than M, and this corresponds to scales which are less than energy scale less than M. Okay. Now, of course, when I say it is greater than M, infinity is greater than M, so it can go all the way to infinity. But just for finiteness, we will say that there is also a cutoff lambda in the thing. In the end, I can always send lambda to infinity if theory is well behaved. So this is going to integrate out all the modes between M and lambda, and lambda is the ultimate cutoff scale in the theory. So you will get this effective action, where everything is going to depend on both the M and lambda. Now I change my M. Suppose I sort of start, so in the energy scale, what we are having is a lambda, which is a cutoff here, this is 0, and you start with some M. Okay? So you first integrate out everything here, and you end up getting a theory which describes things here. Then you change this M to some other M prime. And you ask how the theory changes. Now, I had already told you that when you do this kind of an integral, you end up getting terms, which, for example, you might have originally had an m square phi square, this is going to produce a mu square phi square term. That mu is now going to be a function of m and lambda. If you change m to m prime, that mu will change. Of course, finally, none of the physical effects can depend on these sort of things, which we will see how it happens. But the coupling constants which I am introducing into the theory is going to depend on the scale from which I have integrated out the theory. Okay? So this is probably one of the most beautiful principles which has come in high energy physics, essentially the contribution by Ken Wilson, who got a Nobel Prize for that. This is also probably one of the cases where a purely theoretical exercise got a Nobel Prize, because he just came up with a formalism which completely cleaned up everything, both philosophically and computationally. So the idea here is that, and this is very, very clear in the case of things like condensed matter systems, like a spin system, because that is the correct paradigm to use here. You have a lattice, let us say, so think of, let's say, a square lattice in some d-dimension. And you have things sitting at every lattice side. So at the microscopic level, I can say this is coupled to this, this coupled to this, this coupled to this, etc. On the other hand, I could have just averaged all the spins here out, and I could have now thought of this lattice interacting with a corresponding scale lattice here, with a corresponding scale lattice here. So I have just scaled it all up by one factor, which is just like saying that the M goes to something else, and usually people put some parameter B here, and you think of B as 1 here and B as some other fraction here. So you can keep scaling it. Or b, b square, b cubed, etc., where b is a factor. So that is what we are doing. We are doubling at every state. Okay. So you can now think of the interaction between this block with this block, and the coupling constants which describe that will be different from your original coupling constants. So depending on how much of spins have been integrated out, you are going to end up getting a coupling constant which is going to depend on the scale of the integration, which is exactly what happens here. In the continuum theory, there is this extra complication that there is a cutoff lambda, and when lambda goes to infinity, things can be divergent. But philosophically, it makes no difference to the low energy sector of the theory. The fact that in a good theory, you can do this and reabsorb everything into coupling constants is what tells you that physics is so successful. By and large in physics, high energy phenomena does not affect the low energy phenomena. What is going on inside the atom, if it starts affecting the Navier-Stokes equation, you cannot do fluid mechanics. And if you think about it, it is very non-trivial that if you ultimately, matter is made of, let's say, molecules or atoms, and there is some kind of a Hamiltonian description, and the energy scales involved are some 13.6 electron volts in that, while you are looking at very long wavelength modes corresponding to very low energy scales, and at those energy scales spread over very large distances, none of the microscopic details are affected.
you allow a coarse grain description. And that seems to work even in the field theoretic context. Okay? So this is what we want to do this. Okay, now let us do the maths for this. There you will find that we had actually done most of it. So I only have to do it in a particular way to connect it up with what we have done with. So let us consider a theory where we want to evaluate which is a path integral for that theory, which is described by integral over d phi of exponential I times integral d 4 x some vector. Okay? And the Lagrangian which we are going to take is just the scalar field theory dA phi dA phi. Now we want to do this in such a way that we can actually compute this integration. Okay? So I want to think of this phi as given by some background phi plus some other quantity which I am going to integrate out, that we call this psi for a minute. Okay? So this is like your slow modes and these are like your fast modes. And we are going to take the ultimate slowness of the mode and we are going to think of this as actually constant. So think of this as some kind of a constant and I want to integrate out these times. So if you plug it in, your Lagrangian in terms of size will be, since the phi is a constant, this is equal to dA psi dA psi minus this v of phi plus so I plug it in and now I'm going to also assume that I can do a Taylor series expansion. So I get first v at this quantity. I don't want to keep the linear term because I will necessarily have to assume that if I am going to take it as a constant, it is going to be something in which the classical equations are okay. So the next order correction term which I want to write down is minus half b double prime evaluated at phi times psi square. So what we have done is that since we know only how to do quadratic path integral, we approximate this arbitrary thing as a quadratic path integral with the background term depending on phi. In some cases, like in electromagnetism, it turns out that the dependence on this phi, we will not take it to be a constant. It will take it to be as something which physically corresponds to something which we want to study and where the path integral luckily can be evaluated. If you can have a dependency of x on this phi at the classical solution, but you can still compute the path integral, then well and good. I mean, there are some approximate cases where it can be done. But for the purpose of illustrating what renormalization does, etc., we don't need any other. So we will just assume it to be like this. So if I now integrate the psi, because instead of phi, I am now going to integrate psi over this, what am I going to get? I get a constant here, this I don't care, this is just the original v of phi. It is going to be corrected by an integral which comes from here, right? So this integral, as far as psi is concerned, this is a constant. So this is some dA psi minus half m square psi square or omega square psi square. So this is a free field theory. So we know how to compute the effective Lagrangian for this. Okay, just to remind you, what happens here, this we did long back, so you might have forgotten, I'll just indicate what happens. What you are actually computing is something like an integral over d phi e to the minus in the Euclidean space
half integral d over x, some phi, some operator d, some phi d. Okay, this is the kind of thing which we are doing, and you will end up getting determinant of d to the minus half. Okay, which will go as, if I write it as exponential minus half log determinant of d, which is exponential minus half log determinant of d is trace log d, and log d at this stage it is convenient to write as integral 0 to infinity ds over s e to the minus s d, which is an expression for log. And the trace is going to be an integral over d4x, where you take the x e to the minus s d x of s. Okay? Now this is what we have been calling exponential minus a effective. Again, I am doing in Euclidean, so the I factor go away, which is exponential minus integral d4x L effective. This will tell you that L effective, none of this is new. If you look at your old notes, you will find all these. L effective is minus half integral 0 to infinity ds over s x e to the minus s d. Okay, this is what you will pick. Now, this is what we want to evaluate. Let me just make sure I got the sign right. Yeah. So, this is the effective Lagrangian which we want to compute for this particular case. So, in this particular case, what we will have for D is that L effective. Minus half integral ds over s 0 to infinity x d to the minus s. Let me call this quantity as some omega square, like the square of the. So there will be an omega square and there will be a box, and I am working in the Euclidean sector, so the box will become minus box plus omega square. Okay. So this you go and look it up and you will find that it is there in your notes. So this is what we want to come to. At this stage, I want to mention something which will be useful when we do electromagnetism. What is this? Just to recall an old result, you can think of this D as a Schrodinger Hamiltonian, then this is a coincidence limit of a kernel, right? Now, if it is a Schrodinger Hamiltonian, and you are going to, these are all just some kind of a fictitious Hilbert space, because there is xi which is going into four dimensions. So you are thinking of a Schrodinger equation in four dimensions with s as a time in the fifth dimension, okay? With continuation into the Euclidean. So if you are going to do this, the d in general can depend on the derivatives with respect to x, like this box operator. And it can also depend on x itself. For example, if this phi double, this phi here was not taken to be a constant but depending on x, omega square will be a function of x. So it could also depend on x. Whenever this entire operator is independent of a particular coordinate, that is this x runs into t, x, y, z. Suppose this is independent of any one coordinate, you can convert that particular box operator into a momentum. Because you can just put a momentum complete sets here and integrate over this. things in which there is an H dependence, you have to deal with it separately. This will come in handy when we do electromagnetism, that's why I'm describing it here. In this particular case, if omega square is a constant, it is not going to depend on any of them. So this can be written in momentum space as minus half integral 0 to infinity ds over s integral 4 omega t4p upon 2 pi to the power 4. You just replace derivatives by p whenever there is no x present, which is e to the minus s p square plus m square. Box becomes minus p square. That's it. Okay. Now, this is again trivial because when you do this integral over p square, it's a Gaussian integral over p, is in Euclidean space. You pick up a square root of pi by s for each degree of freedom. And if there are 4 degrees of freedom, it will give you an 1 by s square. There is already an 1 by s here. So the net result will be the sum of both of them. Okay? And the root pi factors, 4 of them, will give you a pi square. Here there is a pi to the power 4, there will be a pi square which is left here. So when you do all this, you end up getting an expression for L effective, which is the following. Minus 1 over 8 pi square integral 0 to infinity ds over s cube. So that is, there is an s square coming from this and there is an s, that is ds over s cube e to the minus s. Yes. This is omega square, where omega square is just b double prime evaluated as phi. This is the quantity which remembers what it is. That's it. This is what we want to compute. Now, when you want to do this calculation, you want to make meaning out of this particular integral. That is where all the divergences and all the non-trivialities, etc. comes in. Okay, there is a half here which I think you have missed. In my notation, in the notes which you will get, it is half omega square. That's correct, because omega square is defined as v double prime, so there is an extra half there. So it is half s omega square, and everything else is fine. Okay? So you have this result, and what we want to do is to do this integral. Now already you can see this integral is divergent. This integral is okay at large s because of this omega square term, but it is divergent at small s. Okay. Now, what is the nature of divergence? Because there is an s cubed here, this is not going to contribute near s is equal to 0, so that is what we want to handle. However, there is one divergence in this which we put in, because we wrote the logarithm, I have wiped it out, the log of x as an integral over ds upon s in u to the minus st. Okay? So that object, strictly speaking, is divergent at the origin, but that we know is a regularizable divergence by subtracting out the background term when omega is equal to 0. After all, if omega is equal to 0 and there is no potential at all, it is still giving you a contribution. That divergent term you can just throw it away. But there are fresh divergences which has come out of this integration. This is what we want to handle. So we want to evaluate this thing, and I can just give you the result, but it is important to see where the terms come from. So I'm going to do that integral a little bit laboriously. And as I said, we can compare it with the notes to check signs, etc. The first thing you do is that you look at the dimensions of these quantities. This s which is coming here is an s which is multiplying p square. P square has dimensions of energy. So s has something like the dimensions of inverse length square. Right? Or s has dimensions of 1 by energy square. Okay? S has dimensions of 1 by energy square, which has the dimensions of length square. So what it is telling you is that the S is probing all the way to zero length. That is where the divergence is coming from. S going to zero is like the highest energies. Now we know that below a particular length scale or above a particular energy scale, maybe the theory is going to break down. So we will introduce a cutoff. Now there are different ways of handling these divergences, and the one which I am going to do here is probably one of the crudest ways of doing it. But it gets you what we want, so we will do it. So this Lagrangian, effective Lagrangian, we will replace. So in the end, we are supposed to take lambda going to 0 limit. And if there are divergent terms and finite terms, we are only going to keep the dominant terms. And whenever any term which vanishes when lambda goes to 0, etc., we are not even bothered. We only want to retain the nature of the divergence. So how do you do that integral? Okay, that integral you can handle by just doing parts. So let me do that. This is minus 8 pi square L effective. Is this quantity. So let us do that anyway. So you think of a first function and a second function. So integral of this is equal to the first function minus integral of derivative of the first into integral of the second. Okay? So you think of this as the second function. Okay, so let me write it down. Let us do first integration of the part. That will be e to the minus half s omega square to integral of this, which is going to be minus 1 by 2 s square. Just watch out for any mistakes in the integration between the limits lambda and infinity, minus integral of derivative of the first function, which is e to the minus half s omega square into minus half omega square times the integral of the second. So this quantity at infinity it vanishes. So at the lower limit, I'm going to pick up a minus, because it is lower limit, that minus becomes plus 1 upon 2 lambda square times e to the minus half lambda omega square. But when lambda goes to 0, it doesn't contribute. So we want only retain things which contribute in the lambda going to 0 limit. So I'm just writing that. Then minus, let us do this integral. So this integral is going to be, this together is minus and minus is plus 1/4 omega square by s square. This is what we want to do. So it is minus omega square by 4 to, same kind of thing, integral of this, that is going to be minus 1 over s e to the minus half s omega square minus integral lambda to infinity ds, derivative of this, which is minus half omega square e to the minus half s omega square, and integral of this, which is minus 1 by s. So let us again take the limits. So if I put the limits on this, lambda and infinity, same thing. At infinity, nothing contributes. At the lower limit, only 1 by s contributes, with a flip in the sign. So I get plus 1 by s. And this becomes minus. This minus and minus gives me a plus, so it is half omega square and then 1 by s. So I keep collecting divergent terms, so there is a 1 over 2 lambda square, then I have a minus omega square by 4 lambda, then I have here a plus omega to the power 4 by 8 integral of this. We are almost there. So this integral, when you evaluate, again use the same logic. The integral of this will give me log s into e to the minus half s omega square minus integral lambda to infinity ds e to the minus half s omega square. Derivative of that would have given me another minus half omega square and a log s. So here when we put the bounds, upper bound again doesn't contribute, lower bound I get a log lambda. With a minus sign. Okay? Now I need to do this. That is going to be plus half omega square log s. This is a finite integral. Okay? So I might as well put lambda equals 0 here. What happens here is that if you rescale, let us call this half s omega square as some quantity x, so that s is equal to 2x upon omega square. So this becomes 2 by omega square and an x. This becomes e to the minus x. And ds is going to pick up a 2 by omega square. That goes away. Ds. Okay? There are two terms here. There is one term with a log x and one term with log 2 by omega square. So the log 2 by omega square is going to integrate integral 0 to infinity dx e to the minus x, which is 1. So I'm going to end up getting 1 upon 2 lambda square minus omega square upon 4 lambda plus omega to the power 4 by 8 minus omega to the power 4 by 8 log lambda. Here I'm going to end up getting plus omega to the power 4 by 8 from this term, and this I will write this as minus log omega square by 2 times this integral, which is 1. Then I have plus omega to the power 4 by 8 times an integral dx e to the minus x log x. This happens to be something called Euler's constant, some finite number. Okay, it is going to be irrelevant for us, so I will just put it here. Why is it irrelevant? It is irrelevant because there is an omega to the power 4 by 8 log lambda. So this is an omega to the power 4 8 times some quantity. I just reabsorb my lambda. Lambda is anyway an arbitrary constant, so I don't care about this. So this is what I get. Before I proceed further, let me just check out all the signs in this. This is a very nasty computation. So I have a 1 by 2 lambda square minus omega square by 4 lambda. Then I have a minus omega to the power 4 by 8 log lambda. Then I have a plus, okay, so it is minus, okay, minus omega to the power 4 by 8 log omega square by 2 and L. Okay, perfect. We didn't goof in. This is what you have. We are almost there. rest of it we will do in next lecture, but let me just write this down. So the L effective in the end has the following structure. This is minus 8 pi square L effective. Minus 8 pi square L effective equals 1 upon 2 lambda square minus omega square by 4 lambda minus omega to the power 4 by 8 log lambda minus omega to the power 4 by 8 log omega square by 2 with omega square being equal to V double prime evaluated at 5. This is a very nice and important result. First, let us look at the divergence of in this, and then we will disperse for the day. There is a divergent term here with 1 by lambda, but this is one divergent term which I can simply throw out. That is because when omega is equal to 0, when there is no potential, no interaction, nothing, I will still get this. Because all the other terms will vanish, but this will still be there. So this is coming from that ds over s log ds which we threw in. So that is just renormalized away because you subtract out whatever was absent even in the absence of omega. It really doesn't matter because finally L effective is going to be varied with respect to capital phi in order to look at any effect of the effective potential. This is independent of omega, so we don't have to worry. Then you find that there are two terms. There is a term here with lambda which diverges linearly when lambda goes to 0. There is another term which diverges logarithmically when lambda goes to 0. Then you pick up a term which is completely finite. Now this is the important thing. We had a set of degrees of freedom phi interacting with a lambda phi fourier. Then we separated it out into slow modes and fast modes and we integrated out the fast mode. Forget how we are going to handle the divergences. We'll come back to that. You are generating a finite term which has a structure which you simply could not have guessed. You could not have guessed things like a logarithm. Okay, which is not even a polynomial term. And that comes out of the computation. So the quantum fluctuations of the fast mode adds a correction term to the slow mode, which are logarithmic in the original potential. So the original second derivative of the potential. Okay, this is the first non-trivial thing. Now, the second thing is that in any decent computation, you don't want to have logs with a dimensionful quantity sitting in. So that is because we were very careful about scaling things down. So what you need to do is that if you look at this, there is an omega to the power 4 log lambda and an omega power 4 upon 8 into log of something else. So what you should be doing is to divide this by some quantity mu and put a quantity mu here. What does it mean? That means that the L effective is completely unchanged. L effective does not depend on that mu which I am going to introduce. But one mu go into the divergent term, another mu go into the finite term. So when you are finally working with the finite term, it will look as though that finite term depends on an energy scale which you have introduced. Okay. This comes about because the infinite term or the divergent term here is going to get absorbed into the coupling constant. And that coupling constant will also depend on that energy. On the whole, when you take the effect of the coupling constant and the effect of the potential, the explicit dependence on the energy scale in the potential and then in any computation, the final result will be independent of that. Okay? So this is the philosophy and it is to show how these logarithmic divergences emerge that I went through this entire exercise. So as you keep doing, there is a stage at which the logarithms start appearing and it is those logarithmic terms which is going to be quite important. So this is a good place to stop. And in the next lecture, we will start looking at the nature of the divergent terms and how to reabsorb them and how that makes the coupling constant. Any questions? Okay, so there is just one more comment which I wanted to make. The technique which I have described here is very, very general. That is, whenever there is an interacting system, integrating out a particular degree of freedom and writing down the effective action is probably the most powerful non-perturbative technique which we now have in order to handle interacting field theory. And is used very much in things where there are fields which are coupled to gravity, etc. Suppose you have your background field which is gravitational and you put some other field in the presence of that. That is, you have, let us say, a black hole spacetime and you put a scalar field in the black hole spacetime. Then you want to know what is happening. Then you can integrate out the scalar degrees of freedom and what you will get is an effective action for gravity. Now, it will turn out that that is a bad effective action in the old fashioned way, that that effective action will have terms which are not present in the original Lagrangian, and if you keep adding, then newer and newer terms will be generated. But